Hello, Bea here, and welcome back to Biology. Do you remember the last time you got sick? Depending on the illness, you may have needed medications such as antibiotics. But if it was something minor like a cold, you probably just waited it out and let your immune system do its job. Within a few days or maybe a week, you probably felt much better. Thanks, immune system! The immune system is a complex network of cells, tissues, and organs that work together to defend the body against disease-causing agents, also known as pathogens. These pathogens can include bacteria, viruses, fungi, and parasitic protists. We'll look at the parts of the immune system today to see how it is able to help us fight off these unwanted invaders. But before we get started, let's look at our goals for this lesson. By the end, you'll be able to explain the three lines of defense of the immune system, describe the role of the lymphatic system, and give examples of immune system disorders. Before we talk about the ways that our body protects us, let's get a few important vocab words out of the way. White blood cells and antibodies are two key components of the immune system that work together to defend the body against pathogens. Remember the parts of the blood that we talked about in the circulatory system lesson? Red blood cells, white blood cells, and platelets? Today, we'll focus on the white blood cells, also known as leukocytes. These cells are responsible for identifying and destroying pathogens in the body. There are several different types of white blood cells, each with a specific function. We'll look at a few different types as we go through the lesson. Antibodies are proteins that are produced by the body in response to a specific pathogen to help remove the invading cell or virus. Don't get antibodies confused with antibiotics. Your body produces antibodies on its own, while antibiotics are a type of medication you may take to help cure a bacterial infection. We'll see examples of white blood cells and antibodies in action as we look at how the immune system functions. Your body's first line of defense against pathogens is your skin. Your skin, along with the mucous membranes in your nasal cavity, form a protective barrier that hopefully keeps most dangerous microscopic critters out. This is why washing your hands is so important. Your skin can keep bacteria outside your body, until you put your hands somewhere that you don't have skin, like your mouth, eyes, or nose. As long as the pathogens are periodically washed off of your skin before they can sneak in through a less protected entry point, no harm done. This is known as a non-specific immune response because it is not specific to one type of pathogen. It simply attempts to keep everything out, good and bad. But if some pathogens manage to slip through these defenses, which they often do, the immune system has plenty more tools in store to fight them off. The second line of defense is known as the inflammatory response. The response is initiated when the body detects the presence of a pathogen or injury to tissue. For example, if you get a cut on your skin, what happens? It quickly turns red and becomes swollen. This is your immune system rushing into action with the inflammatory response because there is a risk that pathogens that used to be on the outside of your skin, where they can't hurt you, are about to slip inside your body through the cut. It's the immune system's job to minimize the risk this presents to your body. During the inflammatory response, the immune system releases a variety of chemicals, including cytokines and histamine. Cytokines are small signaling proteins that regulate the activity of white blood cells and help orchestrate the body's overall immune responses. Histamine is a chemical substance that is produced by mast cells in response to injury or the presence of a pathogen. Among other effects, it causes the blood vessels in the affected area to dilate and become more permeable. This dilation allows phagocytes, another type of white blood cell, to rush to the site and then move out of the blood vessels and into the damaged tissue, where they can get to work. There are several types of phagocytes, such as monocytes and neutrophils, that can engulf and destroy the pathogen once they find it, as well as remove any dead cells or debris. It's a tasty lunch for the phagocyte, the hero cells of our immune system. The increased blood flow and the accumulation of immune cells in the affected area cause the typical symptoms of inflammation, such as redness, warmth, swelling, and pain. The inflammation also triggers the production of fever, which helps to slow down the growth and spread of the pathogen while speeding up the immune response. As we've mentioned before, many of the symptoms you feel when you are sick or injured are simply the result of the immune system doing its job. But without it, our body could easily be destroyed cell by cell from the unmitigated invasion of a pathogen. The inflammatory response is still considered to be a non-specific response because it will attack anything that enters the body, whether it is actually harmful or not. The non-specific responses are also sometimes called the innate immune response, because it is the immune response you are simply born with. Adaptive immunity is a type of immune response that is specifically tailored to defend against a particular pathogen. Unlike the non-specific strategies we've talked about so far, it can provide longer-lasting protection against specific pathogens. The adaptive immune response is carried out by two main types of white blood cells, T cells and B cells, which are both types of lymphocytes. T cells are responsible for directly destroying infected cells, while B cells produce and release antibodies. The response begins with an antigen. An antigen is a molecule that is not recognized by the immune system and assumed to be foreign to the body. Antigens can be proteins, sugars, or other substances found on the surface of bacteria, viruses, fungi, parasites, and even tumor cells. Antibodies recognize and bind to specific antigens, marking them for destruction by T cells. Antibodies are specific to one type of antigen and bind to them like a lock and key mechanism. The T cells then arrive and release toxic proteins called perforins and granzyme, which cause holes to form in the membrane of the cell such that it bursts and dies. The cell it kills may be one of your own cells that was infected with the pathogen, especially if the pathogen is a virus. So, T-cell-mediated killing of infected cells has to be highly specific so that healthy cells are not killed accidentally. But T-cells don't only fight off pathogens. Certain types of T-cells are also able to recognize and destroy cancer cells. And treatments involving the transfer of specialized T-cells to patients fighting cancer have shown promising success. When the immune system encounters a new antigen that it hasn't seen before, it responds by producing specific T cells and B cells that are designed to recognize and attack the cell attached to the antigen. This process creates immunological memory, which allows the immune system to respond more quickly and effectively to future exposures to the same antigen. This is how vaccines work. They introduce an inactive form of the pathogen to your body so that it can create the necessary T cells and B cells. If an active form of the pathogen is ever encountered in the future, your immune system will already be prepared and be able to fight it off much more efficiently. Much of the immune system's work is carried out by the lymphatic system, which helps distribute white blood cells and antibodies throughout the body. Lymph fluid transports pathogens to the lymph nodes, where the T cells and B cells can target and kill them. Have you ever noticed swelling just above your neck when you are sick? Or you may even see your armpits swell and become tender. These are common sites of lymph nodes, and swelling here indicates that your body is busy fighting off an infection. In addition to lymph nodes, the spleen, thymus, and tonsils are all organs of the lymphatic system that play important roles in the immune response. As we went through the lesson today, we saw that the immune system responds to pathogens with three different lines of defense. Our skin and other membranes attempt to keep all foreign substances out. The inflammatory response uses phagocytes to consume any foreign particles that do get in. And the adaptive response targets and destroys specific known pathogens. In the lesson PDF, you'll look at some common disorders of the immune system, including autoimmune disorders, allergies, and immunodeficiency disorders. Next time, we'll take a look at another important body system, the endocrine system. Until then, remember that biology isn't just science, it's the way of life. Hey, hey.